Welcome. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Max Strang, fellow of the AIA, FAIA. He's a founding principal of Strang Architecture, as you can see on the screen. It's a Miami-based firm acclaimed for its site-specific and climate-driven designs. Excuse me for reading from the paper, but in 2016, he was elected to the College of Fellows, as I already said, the American Institute of Architects. In 2013, he received a silver medal from the Miami chapter of the AIA. He's worked in London for Zaha Hadid and New York for shop architects. But his greatest influence has been the Sarasota School architect Gene Leedy. One of Gene Leedy's most famous projects is the Strang House. There's a connection there. Max was raised in this Leedy-designed home, and he later interned in Leedy's Winter Haven office. He graduated summa cum laude with a degree in architecture from the University of Florida, and he has a graduate degree from Columbia University. And if you go on our Facebook page, Harold Buell did a kind of an interview with Max, and you can see, click on that, and you can see that. But in the meantime, you can see him for real right now. Welcome Max Strang.
Thank you, Chris. I'm not Ethan Hawke, by the way, so if you are expecting Ethan Hawke, you're in the wrong building. He's over there. But no, thank you for turning out. We're going to have some fun. I have a lot of slides to get through, but it's going to be fast-paced and fun. I guess we don't have a clicker here, so I usually like to roam around a little bit, but I'm going to be anchored over here to the keyboard this time, so pardon me if I get dull standing in one place. Okay, let's go ahead and start. So, and I guess lights too. And if you get bored looking at one slide, you can look at the other one. So a little context. I was 5 years old one day, and I remember being on my father's shoulders, standing on a balcony at our house in Winter Haven. And we were looking on the horizon, and this rocket took off from Cape Canaveral. So we're still like 60, 70 miles away, but the way our house was positioned across the lake, you could see the rocket launches. And this was actually the Apollo that went to the Soyuz, the Soviet space capsule. I guess America had lost interest in the moonshots, and they had some leftover rockets, and they said, why don't we make a shorter version and go do something with the Russians or the Soviets. So that's what this launch was, and it's one of my earliest memories. But it wasn't just the rocket launch. As the sound wave, I guess back then they didn't douse the launch pad with all the water to keep the sound down. The sound wave about 30 seconds, maybe 60 seconds after launch came rolling across Lake Otis, across our front lawn, and we're standing on this balcony, and the whole house shook. I remember all of the large glass panels just like reverberating, and that was a powerful experience for me. But I'd like to say that it's a different kind of space that captured my attention. It wasn't, well, I do like rockets in space too, but it was something else going on, and this was quite an amazing house to grow up on. To grow up in, if it looks big now, you know, if you're 5 years old, it's a behemoth. So, you know, Gene Leedy, you know, he started his practice here, but he eventually moved it to Winter Haven, and he moved away from some of the smaller one-story wood structures to concrete block and precast. Concrete structural double T's are what those little vertical elements you see there are called. And it's still a courtyard house. It's just a three-story courtyard. But it works because, you know, the whole house is raised up off the ground, and it's got, that was the breezeway you see underneath there. And it was just an amazing, amazing house to live in. So for those of you who don't know Gene or Gene Leedy, you know, he is one of Winter Haven's most revered assets, let's say. He's very gregarious, and he was part of that original Sarasota School group, and just so fortunate for Winter Haven, which is not known for much else besides water skiing and oranges. We have a little bit of culture there now too, thanks to Gene. So this is Gene's office, which is also built out of this precast concrete structural double T's. You know, he loved it because you could get those really long spans, and you know, Gene just liked bold, bigger type of architecture, and the concrete allowed him to do that. So Winter Haven is kind of known as the city of 100 lakes, and there's one lake particularly, Lake Otis, that has several Gene Leedy structures on it. And this is the Dorman residence. And this was his first foray, if you will, into the residential precast double T's at this scale. So I grew up canoeing around this lake, and this house was there. And you know, obviously, like, this was normal. This was a normal house for me, which is strange because, I mean, for most people, it looks more like a parking garage or something else. But for me, in my context, that was normal. That's a recent picture of the house. The house is still there. I guess the great thing when you used a lot of concrete and your buildings, they do last a lot longer. But this house has been well taken care of. But before he did those, you know, larger concrete houses, he did a lot of these smaller little 1,600 square foot three bedroom homes. And this particular home, it's the Kaiser residence in Winter Haven. It's kind of ironic that the cover of the Sarasota Modern book is Winter Haven. But Gene did a series of eight homes, spec homes, for a developer called Craney Homes. And over time, these little structures evolved. You know, some of them just had wood fences, some had concrete block walls, some had pools, some didn't. But Gene, I think he devised an ingenious system of building these homes. It wasn't just to take one home and replicate it or mirror it eight times. He really devised a great a system that, you know, had an express structure and then the skin of the building. And these were done very economically as well. And thankfully, a lot of these still exist in Winter Haven. You guys hearing me okay? Sound all good? Okay, so this is yet another of these Craney homes, and you know, it's just simplicity and beauty of modern architecture at kind of at its best. Some of you might be familiar with the Weaving residence, Andrew Weaving. He purchased one of these homes, and this is the interior and the rear yard of that one, I believe. This has been since changed hands again. I think a couple named Roy and Judy, I forget their last names right now. They're from Brooklyn. They purchased this house, and this is going to be on the, you know, the national AIA convention is in Orlando this year. And Orlando is scrambling to figure out what to do with all these architects because, you know, it's not known for its great urbanity and walking around streets. So they have 200 bus trips all over trying to find things to do with all these architects. And there's four or five of them are coming to look at some of these Gene Leedy structures. And this, we're going to pack a lot of people into this house, but it'll be fun. Here's some other examples of this same Craney type home. And you know, I think in Winter Haven, we're blessed with deteriorating property values. So there's no rampant tear down type situation. So that is what has preserved these homes. It's the same thing that preserved all of Art Deco Miami Beach. You know what I mean? It, the fact that people aren't racing around to tear down these things just to build something bigger, it's not happening really in Winter Haven. So thankfully, that has preserved a lot of these homes. So, I mean, it epitomizes the Florida lifestyle in the same way those Palm Springs modern homes did out in the desert. This house here is the Sparrow House. This was Jean Leedy's first commission in Winter Haven, I think 53, 55. I'm not very good with dates. But I remember as a first grader, my parents made me walk to school every day, and I guess you could do it back then, and I always kind of passed by this house. So I walked by this house every day. And again, it kind of, there's this theme here. I'm just surrounded by great architecture without even really being aware of it. This is a great house by Mark Hampton. He just passed away 2 or 3 years ago, or maybe less. This is in Lake Wales, Florida. And I just put it in here to say, again, that, you know, Central Florida does have some pretty groovy stuff. I mean, this is straight out of James Bond right here. So there's just kind of a collage of a lot of these existing Jean Leedy homes all around. He damn well designed the whole town. You know, he did the city hall, the fire station, the police station, the garden club, the country club, and all these friends' houses. And these are all still there. So I know in the past there's been, you know, bus trips to Leedyland, I think is what you guys call it. So, you know, we're happy to have you over there. I found these just 2 weeks ago when I was trying to put together this PowerPoint presentation or keynote. This is the Ellison House, which was actually Jean Leedy's first pre-stressed double teeth house. And it was just featured on a photo shoot for Vintage Life magazine last December, I think. You know, it's great to see the rediscovery of this. By the way, the neighbors fought that house a lot. They said it was a sewage treatment plant. But you can see some of that Ocala block and some things that are here. Okay, so Paul Rudolph did one building in Winter Haven. This is the Lake Region Yacht and Country Club. This is where I went swimming and played tennis and stuff in Polk County. There's not many yachts in Polk County, but they figured that by having that name in there, they got reciprocity at all the places that did have yachts. So Paul Rudolph was the, I guess, design architect, if you will, and I think this is all correct, but somebody might correct me. And Jean Leedy served as the architect of record. So this is, you know, I look at this and I think of the Sarasota High School, and I see these things. It's a beautiful building right there on the lake. So the last picture of it is this. Aww. This happened 3 years ago, and nobody said anything. Ooh. So Winter Haven needs to kind of grow up a little bit when it comes to appreciating this stuff, because this didn't need to come down. Country Club's replacing it with the Mediterranean-themed clubhouse and whatever. So, you know, this is a, I don't know, it gets me mad too, so. So back to the Jean Leedy House. This actual one is his residence, and it's been modified over time, but this is, I think, one of the, it looks like a professionally staged architecture photo shoot, so he was probably very proud of it when it was first done. And there's the back of that. So our families, the Strangs and the Leedys, were close, and I grew up being best friends with Jean Leedy's son, Ingram, and so I practically lived in this house as well. So I've heard all of the good old days stories of Sarasota from Jean, but you know, my exposure to him was constant and relentless, and somehow along the way, it just, I mean, how could I not choose architecture as a career path is what I thought. So this is the house today. You can see some of the Sid Solomons in there. So as I said, Jean and our family was close. That's my father on the left. And that's Jean telling a very inappropriate joke at a very inappropriate place. But if you know Jean, that's what he does. Something about a tallywhacker, but that's all I could remember. But you can look at the expressions. And so when I said that my exposure to Jean was constant. One day, Gene called my father and said, there's a beach house on Casey Key that you should buy, and it's right next door to me. So my dad purchased it, and it was a shack. All I remember were the rats and the, it was not anything of any remarkable provenance. But it was right next door to Gene Leedy. So when we were on vacation, we were always still around Gene Leedy. And we also happened to be like four houses up from the Deering residence. So I would always go shelling or shark toothing up and down Casey Key. And, you know, here again, it's just this amazing architecture. I couldn't escape it. One of my great memories was when Gene took me to see the Sid Solomon house that once stood on the south end of Siesta Key, or the north end of Casey Key, whichever way you want to talk about it. But again, you can see a lot of similarities to, you know, the houses he was doing in Winter Haven. I believe this house was completed in 66. The house I grew up in was completed in 69, and I was completed in 70. So Sid Solomon, he was an abstract expressionist artist. Most of you probably already know that. He chose Sarasota as their home there and studio. So I remember when Gene took me there, again, it was, look at the south end of Siesta Key. There was not much going on there. There's one more, I think. That's looking north. So you're right kind of where Midnight Pass is, was and looking north. So you can see how far development has surged since the late 1960s. But I remember coming here and just being, like, everything was larger than life. The paintings were larger than life. The colors were larger than life. And Ingram and I would just kind of play in the art studio there. I don't know if you recognize where some of those might be today, but again, bold, powerful spaces and structural expression. That was... So here's a picture of Midnight Pass before it filled in. I don't have a pointer, but maybe my mouse will do it. Nope. Anyhow, there is a speck of, I just want to point out where Sid Solomon's house is, and it's somewhere up there by that group of trees, I believe, right in the beach. And eventually, Midnight Pass decided to migrate north. I don't know the full story. Actually, on the slide on the left, you can see the house there in relation to Midnight Pass. But, you know, it slowly started migrating north, and with time, it took out the house. I remember vividly swimming in the ruins of the swimming pool that was right next to the Sid Solomon house. And I mean, the current was just roaring through there. It was a really fast-moving channel of water. And it took out, probably a handful of homes there. On the slide on the right, you can see the Mediterranean thing. And then right behind that, there's actually two structures, but the one in the middle there is just the studio portion of the Sid Solomon house. So I think they had to demolish it before the ocean got to it, but that would have been a keeper otherwise. So years pass, I go to the University of Florida, but even though I was surrounded by all this architecture, I didn't know I wanted to be an architect. But even when I went up to the University of Florida, Gene Leedy kind of followed me. That's the SAE fraternity house at the University of Florida. I did not join that one. Maybe I had enough of concrete by then, but You know, this is another just great example of his style. And after bouncing around two or three majors for a while, I finally said, you know what, maybe architecture is a calling for me. And once I stepped onto the grounds of the University of Florida architecture building, or campus school, I just knew that I was kind of home in a certain way. And I haven't looked back since. But this is a great building. This is the UF architecture school. And again, all this exposed concrete, immense piers, that's an arcing glass studio wing up there. I mean, it was a powerful building too. So I think I also like powerful architecture. So after I finished my studies at UF, I called Gene Leedy. Actually, I was at the UF Vicenza, Italy architecture program. And I remember calling him on the phone from Italy, and because I was going to ask him to intern with him. And I was so nervous, because I was nervous. And on the scratchy phone, his wife picked up the phone. And I was like, Mrs. Leedy, is Gene there? He's like, he's in the bathtub, but I'll go get him. I'm like, don't worry. He's like, anyhow, I guess they had portable phones back then, before cell phones, and they took the phone there. He did not drop it in the bathtub, but I asked him for an internship there. So just trying to think back of that vivid connection of me being in Italy and he being in his bathtub and saying, you can work for me. I can't pay you, but you can work for me. So I'm like, okay. So these three slides together are wonderful. After my internship with Gene, I went to Columbia University, which he told me that I should not go there. They would screw up my head. And during my years at Columbia, I ended up securing another internship with Zaha Hadid in her London office. And at the time, there's only five people working in her office. It was small. And I remember they had me bring over my own computer to work. And at the time, I think they were doing maybe AutoCAD and using the computer in the office, but they weren't using any 3D modeling software the way we did at Columbia. So I was supposedly the first person to introduce 3D modeling into the studio office at Zaha. Anyhow, I worked there for about two or three weeks and I quit. She was not a very delightful person to work for. And even though it was a very prestigious place to work, I just felt like this ain't for me. And so I quit, but I was still in London for the whole summer and I couldn't get a job with any of the architects because of visa issues and blah, blah, blah. So I just went touring around Wales and other exciting places. And then my next internship was, actually my internship, I guess it was a job by then, was with shop architects. And this is my final year at Columbia, and a good friend of mine was Greg Pasquarelli, who was one of the founding five members of the firm shop. And I told him that, you know, listen, I'm going to go back to Florida. I just, you know, I don't want to stay in New York City. He's like, well, we want to hire you as our first employee, and you'll be the project manager for the Manhattan Museum of Sex, which is called MoSex. So I'm like, okay, well, you know, maybe we'll work out a deal where I live in Florida, because I wanted to set up my own firm. I just had this calling in Florida, and every other week I would fly back and forth and work in New York and work on this. So anyhow, that's kind of what happened. And the Museum of Sex, that was big plans. They're going to have Monica Lewinsky's dress as the lobby centerpiece in there. It's going to be a highbrow experience. Eventually, the two partners of the MoSex development had a falling out, and they ended up just kind of renovating an existing building that was there instead of building this. This did win a Progressive Architecture Award back in 90-something. There is I haven't been there, but you can go and check it out if it's there. So meanwhile, back in Miami, because I moved to Miami to start my own firm, these two little shotgun shacks, if you will, are two of my very first projects. So it's kind of bizarre to juxtapose, you know, working in Manhattan on Sex Museum and now working on two little these things. Anyhow, that's kind of how I started this first year, after I got my license, just taking any and everything that I possibly could. These were in Coconut Grove, by the way. And now I'm going to take you through just kind of a more formal walkthrough of some of our built work. And the Tanner residence is on Lake Otis. Sorry, Little Lake Otis. That's attached like a little epiglottis or something to Big Lake Otis. This is in Winter Haven, and this was a house for my stepbrother, actually. A lot of clients, when you're early in your career, you know, are family, because they can do it for free or something. Okay, so lots of lakes in Winter Haven. This is a wide lakefront lot, and we wanted to stretch the house out so it could have all sorts of views from all the major rooms on the lake. And it was a very simple building construction. We built this for, I think, $120 a square foot. So we just used concrete blocks with precast concrete lintels and created a structural frame. And that's the house. So I've never done any other house again like that, but that was a nice start. And so we inserted these corrugated metal pods, if you will, that inserted into that concrete frame. And this was a house for, I guess, a family of four. There was one day after, remember when three hurricanes crisscrossed Florida at the same time, or the same month, the lakes in Florida went super, super high. And I was able to walk out on the dock with my big Sinar architecture camera and get this shot, because the dock is about 3 inches underneath all the water, but for a long exposure, it was like magic. Okay, so the second house is the house that I built for my family in Coconut Grove. And we call it the Rock House, because there already was a Strang house that I grew up in, and I didn't want any confusion. The Rock House, if you're not familiar with Coconut Grove, I mean, it's the oldest neighborhood of Miami, and it is a jungle. I mean, for some reason, just, it's a riot of green. A lot of foreign invasive plants were introduced there because they thought it was the right thing to do. And they went crazy into the limestone of Coconut Grove. Which, by the way, I added those other circles just so there's other projects that we've done in Coconut Grove, which are all like walking distance away. So I really felt this was, you know, this was our home neighborhood. The house is located on an acre. You can kind of see the distribution of the density of the other houses. So we were happy to find this this size of a parcel there in Coconut Grove. So when it came time for an architect to design their own house, kind of go through a lot of soul searching. I had just returned from a trip to Bali with my wife, and I was just amazed by the architecture in Bali. And I believe, as the story goes, Philip Hiss also did some traveling and came back with some heavy love of what was going on in Bali. And so I got it. There's also other influences, or the Sarasota School type of architecture. The Harkavy house, to me, you know, echoes what Gene Leedy was doing with concrete. So this is what I came up with. It kind of blends the exotic possibilities of Coconut Grove with some of the tectonic possibilities that I felt were in me from my exposure to Paul Rudolph and to Gene Leedy. So what you're seeing is, it's a very simple design. It's this stone house that is clad with this oolitic limestone, which is the bedrock of Miami. So you just, on this particular lot, it's a limestone ridge. You scrape down 8 inches and you hit this rock called oolite, and that's what we use to clad the house. And the upstairs portion, that's steel, that's structural steel. But it's not hard to see the similarities to the structural expression you see in the Sarasota School. That's my son. So I think these family shots are kind of important to kind of show the innocence and the power of the steel. This site diagram drawing, shows it takes up the width of most of the entire lot. And I don't know why, but a lot of our buildings just happen to be elongated and long and skinny. And I think it's because when you're inside those interior spaces, you're never far from the outside and the natural light. So I really enjoy just stretching out the spaces. And then we have to make sure it's buildable. So that upstairs terrace, it's 5,000 square feet of openness for the most part. It's interrupted by three small little pods that kind of start to give some kind of program for like outdoor living, outdoor dining, outdoor kitchen, outdoor whatever. This axo just shows how we put it all together. So the house was 160 feet long, if I recall. I don't know. It's like half a football field. But again, I think you can get across here. The Coconut Grove, it does feel like Bali. If you put this house in any other place, it would look absolutely ridiculous. I mean, but somehow, it works, it resonates with that site. We don't own the house anymore, or else I would not have picked those pillows. This steel columns kind of remind me of the Umbrella House. A lot of people go through a lot of trouble trying to find the right stone and what type of marble do we import from Italy and this, but I mean, look at Keystone in the Florida Keys. You got brain coral, you got star coral, you got shells and mollusks, and that's just, I mean, to me, that's a rich material. Architectural photographers hate shooting this house because the house just dissolves. Picture's beautiful, but you can't see much of the house. And again, that just kind of shows how we lived in it. A little luck is important in an architecture career. And one day we got a knock on the door that they were going to be filming the movie Miami Vice, based on the TV series Miami Vice. And our house was apparently on the radar of the production company to be a good drug lord house. So the location scouts came and said, yep, that'll work. Michael Mann thinks your house is going to be the drug lord house. I'm like, well, okay. And it's going to be based in South America. And one day they called up and asked me for, we made an agreement, but they asked me for all the AutoCAD plans of the house, and they were going to, through the magic of Hollywood, recreate the house in South America. And they did a pretty good job. So somehow it fits there too, right? So, I mean, it's years later, we would have people coming to see the house in Miami to find where the waterfalls were. So in the previous slides, you saw where there's this enormous banyan tree in the backyard. It's like it's actually a Florida strangler fig, which is a native. That tree was not big enough for Michael Mann. So if you see the scaffolding behind the tree, he got some, cut down some roots from other trees in the neighborhood and put them up there to expand the girth of the tree. Because that was going to be the backdrop for the master bedroom they built on the upstairs terrace, which my wife immediately said, why didn't you design the master bedroom on the upstairs? So even though this is how Hollywood might occupy the house, you know, this is the reality of living in a house like that. So I hope that I gave my children some of the same experiences of living, you know, in an architectural significant house. Okay, this is how we do it in Miami. We pack them in there. This is our first waterfront house, non-lakefront, but first waterfront house that we were commissioned to design. It's in South Florida, a little bit north of Miami, and you know, I'm not sure how the lots are distributed here, but you know, we always end up with very narrow frontage and long lots, so there's only a very narrow part of the house that actually is on the water, which can create a space problem, because you don't have the front door right in the street and have them walk, you know, down an endless corridor just to get to where the action is in the back. So in this particular project, we have two courtyards that kind of break up that space. The client also was a regular lap swimmer and said we had to have a 25-meter lap pool on the property, but unfortunately her lot width was only 15 meters, so we elevated the whole living structure up so her pool could run the other direction. So the dinner parties there, I think, are great. Everybody ends up wet. Okay, back to Winter Haven. My parents asked me to design a house for them because all of a sudden they didn't need six bedrooms. They were empty nesters, and so they sold the original Strang residence that I grew up in, and I designed a house for them, which happened to be immediately next door to the Tanner residence. So that's the same lake. And so the black one is this new lake house, and then you see Tanner right next to it. So around this time in the firm, you know, every time I tried to get a client to do this repetitive structural expressive thing, they didn't want it. Even my parents didn't want it. So I started to adopt more of just that clean shell, you know, the clean white stucco shell. So in this house, we used a fake wood. This was going to be a LEED certified house, so using some of the tropical hardwoods were prohibited, and using the FSC tropical hardwoods was super expensive. So there was a product called Resista, which came onto our radar, and it's a fake wood, but you know, there's a purist in me that can't handle that, but because it's made of rice husks, mineral oil, and salt, it kind of has a really natural texture to it. And it was priced below FSC certified woods, so we use that for interior and exterior applications, and it's an interesting product. If you don't like the Trex or some of the other stuff, Resista is a good option. We do drawings too. There's not many houses like this in Winter Haven, because it's Winter Haven. There you can see that resista on the outside. Okay, back to Miami. So, doing a lot of shuttling. This is on one of these man-made islands in the middle of Biscayne Bay. I think they're unapologetically man-made islands, right? I mean, they look like a bunch of lozenges out there. And again, it's a very narrow lot, but a deep lot. And the trick is always, how do you get the people as far back into the house as possible before you let them inside the house? And that's what we did with this. You walk through a courtyard. So the front door is way, way, way in the back. You can kind of see it there. But you walk through this cool louvered entry gate. Then when you get in the courtyard, the house becomes much, much more transparent. And again, this is, you know, a quarter mile away from this house is where that, what was that, face-eating zombie story in Miami like 5 years ago. So, you know, it's not the place you want to enjoy coffee on your front porch and watch the neighborhood activity. Most people want privacy. They want to have their own private experiences with courtyards and backyard views. And once you get in the house, you know, it kind of explodes out across Biscayne Bay. You can see the cruise ships back there. I guess all press is good press. I'm not sure why we came in after dongs on the Playboy website, but Gene Leedy was more proud of me for being in Playboy than any other architectural digest or... Okay, back to Winter Haven. I'm having trouble leaving home, as you can see. Okay, this is a project in downtown Winter Haven. And just for reference, I overlaid all of the existing Gene Leedy buildings that I could think of off the top of my head. So there's still a lot there. There's a lot of critical mass to go there and explore. It's going to take me a while to catch up, I think. So this is an apartment complex. There's nine, I say apartments, but they're more in the townhome style. And here I said, maybe I can get that structural expression going. And the developer said, okay, as long as it's cheap. So these three pictures kind of show the process of working from you know, real rough study models out of chipboard, and then we go into 3D printing, and then we go into actually 3D modeling. That's a close-up of the 3D printing. It's a little, and then we build it. So it's not necessarily the structural, you know, concrete or horizontal members. Here I think I wanted a little bit of the Deering residence to seep through. As you know, the Deering residence been glommed onto by a Key West Mediterranean vernacular something. You can't see it from the street, but you still can see it from the road there on Casey Key. So we built Rain Garden for $110 a square foot. Developer still wasn't happy. So I'm trying to do Rain Garden 2.0 for under $100 a square foot. But I think that I love the challenge of how do you do something great that's also cheap. But this, finally, this was the first downtown residential building and built in Winter Haven in over 25 years. So they finally got with the program. They now have a resurging downtown. There's a lot of stuff going on. By the way, it was the last person that did one was Gene Leedy 25 years ago. So there's 9 units, and it took 2 or 3 months. They sold out for rentals. I think they rent for $1,800 a month. They're 2-story, 2-car garages. And most importantly, though, it's bringing life onto the streets of Winter Haven, which it didn't have. A lot of IKEA there. Okay, so the Hooker residence, the commissions are starting to grow a little bit, not doing shotgun shacks. The Hooker residence is on a canal that looks over Biscayne Bay. And there was a drainage easement that separated the two lots. It was actually built on two separate lots. That's why you see that gap there. I tried forever to see if we could do a bridge over the drainage easement, because who cares that it's in the air and it's a drainage easement, but we cannot get the bureaucracy to work with us. So these are interesting sections too, just for scale. It happens in Miami a lot that somebody will buy, especially one of those real narrow lots, and do a beautiful house, take advantage of the view, and then they park their boat right in front of it and you can't even see anything. But anyhow, this house is designed, you know, we didn't have open water expanse, but we had that little angle. So every major room or outdoor room in the house is geared for trying to get that kind of long water view. That's the pink surrounded islands by Cristo. So it's good to kind of see the art and the architecture coming together. San Marino is another one of these jam-packed islands, skinny lot. This was a spec house. This one was just finished. So we've done two of these spec houses for the same developers recently, and we're about to start another one. For me, though, when I look back for the influence of that, you know, it goes back to this concept of the shell, if you will, and borrowing some language from Robert McCarter, who's a great architectural writer and architect, who describes the shell as a way that an architect can place an inhabitant within a house or structure that is more geared for a horizontal horizon line, a landscape. Somehow there's something with this expressed rectilinear frame that places you on the horizon. And that was, I think, beautifully shown by that top image, which was done by an architect named Jorge Arango. That's the Villa May. It's since been demolished in Miami Beach. But I believe that's the, is it Leavenwood? The Paul Rudolph design, I think it's in St. Petersburg below. So I've enjoyed working with this concept of the frame as well. And, you know, still trying to tease in little influences. That's the Cocoon House, the Healy Guest House by Paul Rudolph on the right, you know, and sitting comfortably by the water with the louvers, and, you know, we got a little bit of that going on the left. So, you know, architecture is much about the detail and the small strokes as it is the big strokes. I think you have to kind of have both to play off of each other. So, you know, for me, working with these louvers and intricate details are something that we do a lot. Just some interiors. Yeah, they block their view. So a lot of those horizontal lines, I can't really point to them well, but we're starting to show these now to all of our clients, factoring in some estimates of sea level rise. So the paddle border that you see there, that's on the current high tide situation. And then I think we have 1 meter of sea level rise. If that happens by the end of the century, that's that next line up, then 2 meters, and then 3 meters. The very high line you see is the peak storm surge from Hurricane Andrew. So thankfully it didn't hit Miami Beach, it hit a little bit further south. But you can imagine with stronger storms now, that surge is going to be on top of those higher base sea level kind of high tide. So it's going to get ugly at some point. The city of Miami Beach is a municipality that is the most forward thinking. Finally, it used to be that we would propose that we would raise our house up by, 3 or 4 feet, just to give a little extra cushion of protection. And Miami Beach said, okay, that's great, you can do that, but the height limit doesn't go up, so you're going to have to sacrifice that on your second floor. And for the amount of money people are paying for these lots, they're not going to sacrifice a whole second floor from a real estate perspective. So then they said, okay, we'll allow you to raise it up 4 feet, but you can then raise the roof too. And then the preservationists say, well, we don't want this bulking new house next to the small house. These are complicated issues. We're still working those through, but at least Miami Beach is kind of finally incentivizing people to raise their house up, not penalize them. But it's been tricky. It's been very tricky to work through. That's the front of that house, by the way. Okay, Ballast Trail's a house in the Florida Keys. It's in near Tavernier. So it's got this amazing hardwood hammock, I think is what they call it. Protected species, and pretty much that's the only place they can build on the lot is on the water, and everything else is now on the record for conservation. So in this case, we decided to pull the house apart into two volumes, because when you arrive at a Keys house, you really don't want to go to the front door. You're hot, you want to go jump in the pool in the backyard. So we want to make a direct access as possible to the back. So this is kind of I don't know what's the front or back of the house anymore. This is the arrival side of the house. But you can see we kind of created this straight shot breezeway going right to the backyard. The client said they had to have a front door, and eventually we put one up there, the stairs on the right, but I don't think they've ever used it. Mm-hmm. This cross section shows that flow from the right to the left underneath that bridge. So this is, that was all Florida Keystone, but we're using it in a very modern way. We're getting a little bit of our structural expression back here. And this has hints of the vernacular as well. When we went before the planning board, or the design review board in the Keys, the first neighbor came up and asked if we could paint it pink, because there were four other pink houses on the street. This would not look good pink. Are some of you familiar with Mountain Lake, Florida? It's nobody? Two, three, four. Okay. How about Bach Tower?
Yes.
Okay. So there is a neighborhood, actually on that image, Bach Tower is, an inch to the right of that circle. So there's Bach Tower Gardens, which is beautiful. But what predated Bach Tower was this neighborhood called Mountain Lake, which is clustered around this lake here, and there's a golf course there, and it's this kind of old world, old money community in the shadows of now Bach Tower. And it's a very conservative neighborhood. Somehow, by the grace of God, we were allowed to get a modern house in there. Gene Leedy has done one in there, but it does have a barrel tile Spanish roof, a gabled roof. And our new client was like, I do not want an old church roof. He was from Austria, and or Switzerland, rather. And he's like, I do not want an old church roof. And I'm like, well, I think Mountain Lake is going to make you do an old church roof. But somehow we got that passed. This is probably one of the more modern houses in all of Polk County right now. We just finished this up a few months ago. But it's a beautiful, beautiful setting. The Bock Tower Gardens kind of spill down to the lake, and I recommend it. We photoshopped as palm fronds, by the way. The house is that new. They hadn't opened up yet. So, I mean, I think it's a nice eclectic interior that kind of merges some antiques and also real modern furniture. And we have the concrete wall. And this is the last house of built work I'm going to show you, the Bass Residence. Okay, so again, this house we just finished, and this isn't part of Miami where you know, like here, you have to raise the bottom floor of the house up for flooding reasons or hurricane reasons. So there was a little one-story house on that property that got demolished right before we went to build. And when they demolished it, this is what was left. The bay, I mean, this tells you how low Miami is. How do you build in that? You know, it's like building a dam or something. But yes, we use piles. I think here they go down to about 25 feet before they hit bedrock. How deep are the piles here? How, 60? Oh, geez, okay. I should be lucky at 25 then. But yeah, so we have to build in piles and we have to build up. This owner has a great art collection. When we started designing this house, we kept kind of looking off the survey and trying to figure out the setback from the city for our rear yard setback, and things weren't adding up. And we finally realized that the property line was about 15 feet out in the water. And I thought for sure the city was going to force us to do it even further back, but this is probably as close as you can get to the water with the house in Miami now, but it feels like you're on this like concrete cruise ship. And this is in Coconut Grove. So our projects have started to kind of go into the Caribbean a little bit more. We have some projects in Bahamas, Dominican Republic, and Dubai, a little further to the right. So we have a lot going on. And what I want to underscore is it's more than one person, you know, to do these projects. We really have a great team in place. We have 14 of us working in the Miami office. We just opened up office in Fort Lauderdale, where we have 4 people working. And every quarter, every 3 or 4 months, we try to go on these big office team field trips where we load people up on a bus and walk through everybody else's other project managers, projects. That's how you learn. You know, getting out into the field when things are being built is important. So we lose a little productivity every few months because everybody's out of the office, but I think we gain so much more by just taking the time to take our staff through. That's our Christmas party. So real quick, here's just kind of some of our projects in the works right now. This is in Coral Gables. The landscape architect, Raymond Jungles, had 15 years ago excavated this amazing grotto before Coral Gables found out he was excavating this amazing grotto and shut him down. And 2 years ago, we got the commission to do an addition to an existing house that's there in the background. And Raymond, actually this time, we got the right permits and he was able to finish what he started a long time ago. So all of these here are under construction right now. These are some interior renderings. The renderings are getting very, very, very good these days. So it's sometimes these are all fake, or not fake, but they're not real. But you can see that I had to add a little Sid Solomon photo there in the bottom right. So why do a black steel house in Miami? This might be a horrible idea, but I said we can only do this if we have just a dense, dense grove of coconut palms over the whole thing. You know, if you go to Singapore and other tropical locations, they do use black and ebony a lot, and the green looks so good against it. So we'll let you know. And this is just a point I want to make where that's the Paul Rudolph design for the Milam House in Pontevedra, I believe, on the bottom. And that's one of my designs on the top. And it's, to me, it's the same thing. You know, it's when the house and the architecture is performing in response to the climate, in this case, mostly shade. You know, the coolness or style of the house kind of comes with it. So if you can, you know, engage and adopt a cool system of design, you know, the house can look good on itself without trying. It's our first one-story commission in Miami Beach, I think, ever. So there are people out there that don't want to just go bigger and better. He's fighting all of the advice of his friends who says you have to max out for real estate purposes only. So I give this guy a lot of credit for he and his wife and their three dogs. So why? You don't always have to speculate. This is a house that we've designed in the Bahamas, in the Abacos. So this is a vacation beach house on an out island. And this is a house for a famous tennis player that I'm not allowed to name. She and her wife have designed a great little thing here. Renee, you might recognize that one. And again, this is a design we did for Coconut Grove 6 years ago. And the bottom is a Paul Rudolph design. So these are, to me, these are timeless ideas. And you know, I think we should keep embracing them because they're not stale, they're timeless. First condo project here in Coconut Grove. There in Coconut Grove. We tried to envision these as a series of stacked single family residences. With a cool rooftop. So this is the house that was on the poster, on the flyer. It's the Tuckman residence. It's in Fort Lauderdale. Again, you can kind of see some of the sun shading and privacy responses end up with the style of the house. This is 3D printing. For those of you that aren't familiar with the 3D printing technology, this is a machine that kind of spits out the model. So instead of, you have your computer, instead of pressing the word print and it goes to printer, you press build and it builds it. So this probably took a lot, I don't know, 40 minutes for this thing to slowly build up this 3D model. And it's there's a lot of misfires and a lot of misbuilds, if you will. But you know, you can get these cute little I call them bug models to kind of start to look at forms and stuff. You really can't get these big spatial experiences from them yet, but actually just 2 days ago in Russia, they 3D printed an entire house. It was a very ugly house, but you know, they can print it. So here's a construction photo of this house under construction. We have several more months, a lot of more months left to go. But we did some bold cantilevers here. This kind of looks like a highway off-ramp when they brought all this steel in. And believe it or not, it's kind of hard to see from that picture, but that entire cantilevered structure in that area, it's supported by only that one block wall that you see there. All that other looks like a cube. That's not structural. Only that last little wall is concrete and steel. I had the structural engineer recheck his numbers after they poured that. I sprinkled in some of the drawings that we do. I like to always keep the artistic side of architecture alive. We had a gallery showing in Telluride not too long ago that kind of shows off some of the sketches as art. Another shameless plug, we have our first book coming out. It's a monograph by Oscar Rihara Ojeda Publishers. They do really great architectural monographs. That'll be out, I think, in April or May. In fact, I contacted Janet a few months ago and was like, hey, I have this book coming out. I want to do some lectures in the fall. She's like, well, how's March? So I'm like, lastly, this is my brain. it's hard. If you look in the upper right of the screen, there's icon on top of icon, icon. I mean, if you extrapolate it, it's probably a meter deep of icons like that. So somehow every 2 months I'm able to take a whole day and clean my virtual desktop. But we have a lot of projects going on and we're excited about all of them and have a hard time saying no. And for those with very acute eyes, if you look in the far back wall, that's a Sid Solomon print that is kind of hanging over my desk. And on the left it says the Ringling Museum of Art. So I kind of feel like this is a homecoming of a certain way. So thank you for the opportunity to share.
Before we can take some questions, right?
I can do questions.
Before we do questions, let me let you know, if you haven't been to Winter Haven, they have a wonderful, they've done this tour. Mm-hmm. You can go to winterhaven.org or whatever, .gov, and you can download these little snippets of descriptions of the buildings on the tour. And then, you go along the tour. I think you go to the city hall and you pick up
It's a driving tour.
Yeah. And then you drive up in front of the place and you press play and you can hear, maybe 3 minutes, 2 minutes of someone speaking about it. So it's something we should do for Sarasota.
Any questions? Yes.
I am very curious how much those spec homes that you showed about 20 minutes ago that you're dealing with the same developer. Mm-hmm.
It sold for $14 million, that last one.
Oh my goodness.
How big are they?
6,500 square feet, 75, something like that. Yeah. Yes?
I remember a trip to when the Residential Architecture Magazine was in
Coconut Grove, Miami.
Yeah, it was in Coral Gables. We went to your house.
Yep.
And it was brand new, I think, at that point. And I don't know how long you lived in it because you said that you moved, not to where. What I wanted to know is not everybody lives in a house that they designed. And what did you learn from that experience? What would you do? What would you have done differently at the end of that, aside from?
Well, I ran out of money.
Yeah.
In fact, when the producers of Miami Vice came, there were portions of the bottom of the house that were not clad in stone because I simply ran out of money. And they were proposing their art department was going to make faux stone to clad that up. And I said, well, I don't mind if you want to get the stonemason and do the real thing, you know? I said, if you do that side, make sure you do the other side too, so it all balances. And they did it. They did it. So thank you, Miami Vice, for finishing the house. If anything, I probably overreached on the scope and the budget. So that was back when WAMU was giving out those wonderful loans, and you know, I couldn't resist. Yes.
On the interior, what material do you use? What would you use? Are you using drywall or
finished? Is that in general, or that one house? In general, we do use a lot of drywall for flooring. We're using a lot of the porcelain tile wood now. A lot, just you know. The biggest debate we have with every client and ourselves is on the exterior use of wood. Maintenance versus durability and look. I don't know. That seems like the revolving question we have every single time. We do some woods on the inside too. There's teak. I think that was the mostly teak kitchen. Yeah. Yes.
People say that the most important job architect has is to take that job. When mm-hmm. did you realize that you had something that was really moving and had a lot of momentum?
I showed you the two little shotgun shacks, right? Yeah. Those are probably the best looking of 30 other odd jobs and renovations we did at the beginning. The first thing I put my stamp on was an actual crack house renovation that was on the tax rolls of the city of Miami, and a developer bought it and painted it green. Anyhow, I took any small job that I could get at the beginning. I think the rock house was the one that started. So that's where I said a little luck can come into play. And it was a cool house.
What was your experience working with contractors? Do you have a regular group of contractors that your work has got a lot of detail?
We have some favorite contractors that we like to work with. And I'll say this. We've now in our contracts, all of our construction observation is on an hourly basis. Because when the client makes the decision with the contractor, we don't know if they're going to go with the one that's going to take, you know, the shortest amount of time or the longest amount of time to do it. And we've had, some situations where it just gets elongated forever because of contractor issues, because they went cheap on the first price and it came back to cost them.
Did you need some going to architecture?
No, Gene Leedy's son did not go into architecture. He ran far, far away from it, I think. And he's got a daughter too, Safi, which I'm...
One more question on the architecture. A lot of the floors is polished concrete.
Some of it was polished concrete. Yeah, yeah. Yes?
You mentioned zoning. Do you deal with that, or does your owner or the contractor?
The architects deal with zoning.
So how does that work in the Bahamas? What's the
good question? depending on where in the Bahamas, it's anything goes. For building code for buildings, we build to Miami standards for wind and stuff like that. But you know, on the small out island, there can be a local council of four people and say, as long as it's not higher than a coconut tree, it's fine. So, yeah. Yes, yes, sir.
Over the course of your career, have you seen a change, like you mentioned just now about Miami standards, have you seen changes for wind and water and natural, like hurricanes, that kind of thing?
You know, in South Florida, and I think here to some degree too, we have very, very strict product approvals for what type of window product or what type of guardrail or whatever, which is great from a life safety standpoint, but that can really kind of hamstring us too, because you know, back when Paul Rudolph and his crew were doing their thing, it was anything goes. And so what we're challenged with now is if you saw that that interview with Harold today, I talked about it's a struggle for us to get that delicacy of the building. You know what I mean? Because, and the scale too. You know what I mean? I think everybody wants small scale house, the look of it, but then they give me 8,000 square feet of rooms and, you know, and it's hard to keep that scale. So that's what I find myself struggling with the most, because there's only a certain window size you're allowed to do. And you aren't allowed to have those tremendous glass walls to open up a whole house anymore because of the Florida Energy Code, which is a good thing, but I'd like to have long glass walls. Yes?
So you mentioned that your parents' house was a LEED project, and you also talked about sea level rise. I'm just curious, coupling on the last question, the energy efficiency response, what your perspective is on LEED in general, and maybe your own sort of take on what an energy efficient house is or what a sustainable house is, and how you implement that into your design.
Well, the sustainable house is the one you don't build. So you've probably heard that answer before. The LEED, we did not ultimately get the LEED on my parents' house, but the reason was my father's health declined and he was in charge of that, and it became a personal mess, and we didn't proceed. In Miami, we did work on the first commercial interior LEED project in the county, but these days, we're not mandating that all of our projects are LEED. We try and do the best we can, making the smart decisions on our own. We have solar panels and the cisterns, and we're doing the Tesla power walls, and we're trying to stay up with all of that and make smart decisions. But unless the client mandates it to us, we don't do that as a habit. But we have done it on occasion.
Are you interested in any municipal, like library or anything like that?
I would love it. Even like doing that condo tower, you know, it's still residential, but it's, you know, a little out of what we do typically. But in those cases, you know, we serve as a design architect, and there's usually a architect of record that assists with that project. I was going to say one thing too that I forgot to mention during the slideshow is I'm working on a project in Winter Haven now to build up to 25 of these, our own replicas of Gene Leedy's early houses on these lots. So, and providing for under $250,000, you can have one of these, you know, you can start with a 3-bedroom, 1,600 square foot house. We're working on getting the original drawings up to code, if anybody's interested, let me know afterwards. And but you know, I think we're at a crossroads in Winter Haven, and there's an opportunity there that we can buy these lots for $15,000, and we can build for $100 a square foot. And so the math is in our favor. Places that are just simply would not work here. And so we're looking at Nick. I think some people might want a vintage replica of one of these things. Some people might want the same floor plan, but you know, maybe updated with concrete roof or some other kind of system. And then we're going to sprinkle in our own designs too. But you do get air conditioning. That's a good question. Okay.
Do you have any? I don't know how familiar, how much time you spend in Sarasota these days, or mm-hmm. how familiar you are with it in the last years, but do you have any comment about Sarasota architecture in general, where we're at?
Let me approach the answer this way. 2 weeks ago, I just went to Palm Springs for the very first time for their Modernism Week, and everybody here should go do that. It's a really, really fun experience. You know, they have a critical mass of those mid-century projects on a scale that we don't have here. But I also there saw the exact same issues of the McMansions popping up around them. And again, it's kind of a buzzkill, you know what I mean? Yeah, I wish there were stronger historic or stronger zoning regulations in place to kind of keep that integrity. And I think, I don't know anything about how you're dealing with historic preservation and the zoning side of things, but, you know, obviously in Lido Shores, it would be great if there was a little more, I don't know, I'm preaching to the choir, but, you know, I wish there was more respect in general for, you know, those mid-century designs, and I think everybody here would agree. How do you do it? And I think, you know, I think the real estate community has found a way to maybe get a little bit more for the good ones of those. And so I think it's just what you guys are doing here, the foundation, is just keep on spreading the word, and it gives culture, it's heritage, and, you know. We're trying to get that launched in Winter Haven. We're trying to formalize some group in Winter Haven to really do what you guys have already done. So we might be cutting and pasting some of your initiatives. None of the buildings in Winter Haven are historically designated. We need to do that. We need to get a book on Gene Leedy. That's never been done. I'm not sure there's ever been a retrospective on Gene Leedy's work. I know he's been participating in some of the Sarasota School stuff. And then we want to do some of our own replicas and build our inventory of these homes. One day I want Winter Haven to be synonymous with, you know, a mid-century modern Mecca in the way that Sarasota or Palm Springs is. And I think there is a demand for that because it's real.
So are you then in favor of the historic district and the historic district?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I don't think Gene Leedy is, though. But he's got a nice ego on him, so if you tell it's his building, then maybe he'll do it. Okay, well, thank you very much. I look forward to coming back again.